Hi, it's Phil Harris here for Guitar Interactive magazine. This particular subject we're doing today is the late, great Gary Moore. I'm very excited about this because Gary and I did share a lot of times together in the 1970s and the 80s because I had the same management as Gary when Gary was in Thin Lizzy, and I had the same management as Thin Lizzy at the time. And we did hang out and talk guitars and chat about all sorts of things at the time. I first met Gary in 1973. He had an original Gary Moore band, which was before, I think it was after Skid Row, he formed his own band. And they were sort of touring up and down the motorways, as I was at the time in another rock band. And what actually happened was we used to meet at the Blue Boar. If there was anything going on about 2 a.m, all the bands that had been up the north of England that were coming back about 2, 3 o'clock in the morning would congregate at the Blue Boar. And I used to see Gary sort of bleary-eyed and myself in the same sort of state, really. And we'd sit down, have a coffee and a chat and eat sausage, egg and chips or whatever it was at the time. Because it's before the days of healthy eating and all that sort of stuff. So we was basically loved our sort of 10 million grams of fat, as it's now shows a bit too much on me. But anyway, so I've got a lot of association with Gary, not only as the person, but also musically, because he is one of the people that come from the same stable of inspiration as I have. And we shared the same period in time around the 70s, the rock era. I even had a little stint for 3 months with Thin Lizzy after he left Thin Lizzy the first time. And so we have crossed paths along with this guitar also that I'll get to in a minute. So I was very excited when Guitar Interactive actually asked me to do a piece on Gary. So it's going to be a good one, this one. I've got a feeling about it. It's going to be a really good one. So we're going to start off with nuts and bolts of it all. We start off with the guitar, which you've seen before, and I would say you recognise this as the Peter Green Gary Moore guitar. I actually have said this before. I met Gary the night he got this guitar from Peter Green. He was playing in London at a university, and I popped down to see him with a friend of mine. And it was a blinding gig. He was absolutely on fire that night. And this guitar, honestly, you wouldn't believe, he got it that day, put some strings on it. He went on stage and he had this PV stack that I thought at the time, what are you using a PV stack for? And an Echoplex, because he asked the management for a PV stack and an Echoplex, which they duly bought him, because whatever he wanted, he had to get, because that was how he was going to get his sound. But I think the PV lasted about a week, but the Echoplex stayed a lot longer. But so anyway, it was a great gig. I thoroughly enjoyed seeing this guitar because in a past interview about the Peter Green, I mentioned how I saw it when I was 15 years of age with Fleetwood Mac and whatnot. But this is obviously about Gary. So great gig that night. Then I went on to see Gary quite a lot around the Coliseum 2 era. So I saw the guitar a lot and I met Gary quite a few times. I remember one particular time I went to the Tunnel Studios, the rehearsal studio, where he was there with Coliseum 2. And I was there basically picking up a couple of amplifiers I'd left there to be repaired. And Gary stopped the rehearsals and we sat outside just basically just shooting the breeze and talking about what's happening, what I was doing at the time, what he was doing with Coliseum. And it was really nice. I remember driving down Edgware Road one day and I saw Gary with this guitar in its brown case, the original case at the time, at a bus stop, looking a bit worse for wear, bless him. He'd obviously been partying and the next day he wasn't necessarily quite recovered. So I remember picking him up and taking him back to his flat and we had a bit of a gas on the way. There were so many little meetings I had with Gary about that time along, basically, along every week, we'd meet the managers down at 52 Dean Street, and we'd meet up there to for meetings and things, and Gary would have this with him because he never left it out of his sight. So I saw lots of the guitar, and I saw lots of Gary in that period, and it was really quite cool. We lost touch during the 1980s, and by the late 80s, I had a phone call from Gary's guitar tech, Graham Lilly, and he said to me, Gary wants to buy another Les Paul Standard. And I thought, okay. And I had two. I had one that was a dark burst and one that was a light burst, very worn, but with a lot of flame on it. That's to say, a lot of stripe on it, which is what the nickname it ended up being called by. So I went over to Psalm Studios and gave Graham the guitar. Gary was busy working downstairs, probably with Albert King or whatever, I'm not sure, or Albert Collins at the time. So guitars went down and the dark one come back up and Graham said, Gary loves the light stripy one. I thought so, because I played that guitar and it was much more, there was a Gary Moore Les Paul that was about Gary. It was that guitar. And he bought it, and the rest is history. He used it on part of Still Got the Blues. This guitar was used on other parts of Still Got the Blues. And Gary, true to his dedication to that guitar, kept it and used it until his untimely death, and the guitar stayed with him. Stripe was there right to the very end, which I feel actually quite humbled that I had the pleasure of selling him that guitar that he felt so close to, and it was his soulmate in a guitar. Today, I wanted to try to give you as much of the feel of him as I can possibly do. So I basically employed a JCM 900 Marshall, because Gary would show up anywhere, and if it had Marshall on the front, he'd make it scream, sing, and do the Watusi. So I know he used a lot of vintage amplifiers and different things for recording, but his real life squeeze would have been this sort of thing, a JCM 900, a JCM cab. He may have doubled it, he may have quadrupled it, but that's the sort of essence of it. So today, that's what I thought we'd use to sort of keep in the real vein of what Gary used and what was going on. And I'd like to sort of play a little piece now, if possible. This one is... This is my take on a few bits, but this particular thing is like a sort of a bit from Still Got the Blues, really, and just blowing a bit and hopefully putting the point across what those amps done with this guitar with Mr. Moore. So we'll give it a try now. A little bit of that aggression, using the tone of the guitar, using the amplifier and growling away on it all, was something he could do as second nature. And it's nice to me to be able to be let loose without people telling me I'm playing too loud or the neighbours getting on the case. So I really do enjoy the fact I can sort of let rip a little bit and be given that scope to be able to sit here and actually play a few bits and pieces to you guys. So that's a little bit of the sort of typical, stereotypical side of Gary. There's another side to him which is much more bluesy and very subtle. And that type of thing would be one of my favourite, pardon me, one of my favourite songs from Still Got the Blues is Midnight Blues. I took this guitar to Joe Bonamassa in March last year at the Albert Hall. And we were talking together and Joe said to me, I said, we'd like to use a guitar. So he said, yeah, I'd love to use a guitar. And I said, well, what sort of thing would you want to do? He said, well, I don't know enough about Peter Green to be able to do it real justice on Peter. He said, but Gary is someone I've related to all my career since I've been playing guitar as a young boy. I've been listening to Gary Moore and Gary Moore's been one of my biggest influences. So I'd like to play on this guitar, Midnight Blues, which he did. And there's recordings of that, YouTube, whatever, which he played it fabulously. So I've, like most guitar players, I don't sort of do the jukebox thing. I just do what I do, which is my version thereof. But I sort of worked out and mucking around myself for fun, just to my take on that. So I'd like to play that to you, sort of give you an idea of that more subtle side of Gary, plus obviously using this guitar that would have been used on the original track to actually just exercise some tonal control from that. Might have noticed I've swapped the Les Paul for a Strat. The reason being, at the anniversary, the Fender Stratocaster anniversary for 50 years, was at Wembley Arena. And Gary appeared there playing a red Strat, his Fiesta red Strat. So I just thought, just for the looks a little bit, we'll use a Fiesta red Strat. The model isn't quite the same, but I don't think it really matters. Gary could have played a broomstick and got the right sound out of it. So I sort of went with the sort of feeling of that. So He played that night, and he played Red House by Hendrix, a tribute to Jimi Hendrix. It was a night of the Strats, very fitting tribute. So I thought I'd sort of dig out a Strat and we'd have a go at that a little bit and just sort of get a little feel from that night. Hopefully you can recreate a little bit. It'll be really good. So with this Stratocaster, we're gonna hopefully have a little bit of a go and see where it takes us. So this is Red House a la Mr. Moore. Anyway, that's my sort of loosely based Harris Moore type of style there. And let's say Moore Harris, actually, let's get it right, because obviously he done a lot better than I just did. But at least I want to try and put it across the night, Wembley Arena, 2004, 50th anniversary of the Stratocaster guitar. What an icon. And there was an icon on the stage playing his Fiesta Red Strat and completely knocking everyone dead, including myself. Thoroughly enjoyed it. But as we say, we're talking about everything to do with Gary Moore today. One of the best guitarists who ever come from our shores, the Irish shores. And for me personally, it was such a big pleasure to have known him. And he was a very... He was like he was as a guitar player. He talked to you with amazing venom, amazing directness, and that come out in his playing. What he was what how he played, and that was how he basically took everything on board and converted it through his personality and his ability into what we've got now, which really is it's a great legacy, because there are great guitar players, there are fantastic guitar players, and at the top of that there are iconic guitar players, and Gary was an iconic guitar player. And for me personally, he's the only person that I actually rubbed shoulders with at the times all these things were happening and all the different bits and pieces that was going on throughout sort of Thin Lizzy, the Gary Moore Band first, then Thin Lizzy, Coliseum 2, and as a solo artist, and even having the I was instrumental in getting him his most loved 59 Les Paul. As beautiful as this is, this guitar, great guitar, and obviously Gary got so much from it, but I really do feel very humbled the fact that I was helpful in the chain of events that got him Stripe, which was the 59 Les Paul standard that he kept for the rest of his life. And after our associations in the 70s and the 80s, to be the person, I'm another Burst fanatic as Gary was, to actually give him the guitar that really hit the nail straight squarely on the head, but something that I'll always feel really good about, that I'll always think of with a smile with Gary for the rest of my life. And let's celebrate one of the best guitarists, probably might be the best guitarist, certainly from Ireland, and certainly in line in the top 10 from England. Before Gary joined Thin Lizzy the first time, the guitar player was a great player that I used to have the pleasure of playing a lot with. In fact, I toured Ireland after my little sort of shindig with Phil and the boys, and he guested on the whole tour with us, and it was a real privilege. It was Eric Bell. It was the first Thin Lizzy guitarist. And they'd done the rocker with Eric, but when Gary did it, it sort of took on a whole different meaning. He just took it up to another planet. So I'm just going to finish off. This is the last little piece. We're going to do just a little bit of rendition of a rocker-esque type thing, a la in Gary's style, you know. We'll be right back.